إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. ما بعد، today inshallah we will explain page 213 Surah Yunus chapter 10. الله سبحانه وتعالى says أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قل هل من شركائكم من يبدأ الخلق ثم يعيده قل الله يبدأ الخلق ثم يعيده فأنى تؤفكون قل هل من شركائكم من يهدي إلى الحق قل الله يهدي للحق أفمن يهدي إلى الحق أحق أن يتبع أمن لا يهدي إلا أن يهدى فما لكم كيف تحكمون وما يتبع أكثرهم إلا ظنا إن الظن لا يغني من الحق شيئا إن الله عليم بما يفعلون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say, is there of your partners one that originates the creation? So ask them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these Ba'athists, is there of your partners one that originates the creation and then repeats it? Say, Allah originates the creation and then he repeats it. Then how are you deluded away from the truth? Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is there of your partners one that guides to the truth? Say, it is Allah who guides to the truth. Is then he who guides to the truth more worthy to be followed, or he who finds not guidance himself unless he is guided? Then what is the matter with you? How do you judge? And most of them follow nothing but conjecture. Certainly, conjecture can be of no avail against the truth. Surely Allah is all aware of what they do. So this invalidates and falsifies the polytheist's claims for committing shirk, for committing polytheism with Allah and worshiping different gods, false gods and idols and rivals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking them, these gods that you worship, is there anyone among them who creates the creation and then brings it back to life after its death? Is there among these false idols that you worship anyone that originates the creation and then repeats it? Meaning, who is the one who started the creation of all that exists, heavens and earth, and created all the creatures that exist in them? Of course it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who is going to bring them back from death back to life on the day of judgment? It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who can place the planets and the stars in their orbits and positions in the sky? Of course it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who can then repeat the process of the creation, as we said, after we die and all the creatures die on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to bring us all back to life. So it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not these false gods that the polytheists worship. And Allah does this by himself, alone without partners. So how can you, O polytheists, worship other partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَأَنَّا تُؤْفَكُونَ Then how are you deluded away from the truth? Of course, the truth is to worship Allah alone, but you are deluded away from the truth by worshiping false gods. How is it that you are so misled from the right path to falsehood? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them another argument. قُلْ هَلْ مِنْ شُرَكَائِكُمْ مَنْ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقَّ قُلِ اللَّهُ يَهْدِي لِلْحَقَّ أَفَمَنْ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقِّ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُتَّبَعَ أَمَّنْ لَا يَهِدِّي أَمَّنْ لَا يَهِدِّي إِلَّا أَنْ يُهْدَى أَمَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ Say, is there among your partners, your false gods that you worship, anyone that guides to the truth, say it is only Allah that guides to the truth. So you know, O Parthians, that your deities, your false gods, are incapable of guiding those who are astray. It is Allah alone who guides the misled and confused ones and turns the hearts of his creation from the wrong path to the right path. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. None has the right to be worshipped but he. Is then he who guides to the truth more worthy to be followed, or he who finds not guidance himself unless he is guided? So statues can't really move from one place to another unless humans that worship them move them. So they can't even move themselves from one spot to the other. How can they guide people? Will the servant then follow the one who guides to the truth, who is Allah, so that he may see after he was blind, he may see the truth after he was blind to the truth? Or should the slave follow one who does not guide to anything, these false statues, except towards blindness and muteness? And that's why Ibrahim alayhi salam said this argument to his people, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Maryam. Ya abati ma ta'budu ma la yasma' wa la yubasir wa la yughni 'anka shay'a. Oh my father, why do you worship that which hears not, sees not, and cannot avail you in anything, cannot help you? These statues, these false gods, they themselves need help. How can you worship something that is helpless? And also Ibrahim alayhi salam said to his people, أَتَعْبُدُونَ مَا تَنْحِتُونَ وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُمْ وَمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. Do you worship that which you yourselves carve? I mean, these statues, they were stones, and you're the ones that made them. So how can you make something with your own hands and then worship them? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created you, and Allah has created everything that you do. Everything that human beings have made. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who created this ability in them by giving them the brain, giving them the knowledge, giving them the hands to do that, giving them the metals to build these things. So one cannot say that human beings did something. No, human beings never created anything from scratch. Human beings only mold the existing things that Allah put in this earth to fit their imagined innovations. So iron, it's not human beings who created it. They actually use iron from the earth. You know, the fact that they build these, let's say, airplanes, robots, etc., phones. Yeah, I mean, we can say that, you know, mankind has progressed on a technical front, obviously, but of course on the religious and behavioral front, they are worse. They are the worst throughout the history of mankind, because of course nowadays they allow things that even those that originated the evil knew that it was evil, but the people today say that it's not evil, it's actually a right. Like we're talking about the homosexuality, that people today in many countries, they enact laws to allow that, while the people of Lut, the people who actually innovated this evil act, they themselves knew that it was evil, because they said about Lut alayhi salam, they said, innahum unasun staharun, kick out Lut and his family, because there are people who want to be pure. So even the people of Lut knew that what they were doing was impure. Mankind today, they don't call this impure. They say, no, it's a right. That's why we say that even though technologically mankind has advanced to the point of being able to put nuclear weapons in up in orbit in the sky and point it towards Earth to destroy mankind, on the religious and behavioral front, they are the worst throughout the history of mankind. So everything that mankind has created today, it is through the knowledge that Allah has given them, and through the material that Allah has put for them on this earth, and through the brains that Allah gave them, so that they are able to think about these things. So they can't think that because they made these artifacts, these objects, these electronics, just because they're able to do it doesn't mean that they are beyond the reach of Allah or beyond the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who gave them this ability. That's why Allah says, why Allah has created you and what you make. Even those people that make statues, the ability of carving these statues and the ability that Allah has given them. But of course, they use this ability in evil as opposed to using it in goodness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's why it tells them, فَمَعَلَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Then what is the matter with you? How do you judge? What is the matter with you? What happened to your mind? How did you make Allah's creatures equal to Him? Be it a statue or a prophet or any type of animal that are worshipped in some places of the world, the stars, etc. What kind of judgment did you make to turn away from Allah and worship this or that? Why did you not worship the Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, glorified be He, the true King, the judge, and the one who guides to the truth? Why didn't you call upon Him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and turn towards Him instead of turning towards these creatures that can't help themselves, let alone help you? Allah then explained that they did not follow their own religion out of evidence or proof. They just followed conjecture. The fact is that they were following mere conjecture and imagination. Oh, I think that this is the right way. I think we should do this. I think we should do that. So yeah, this is a conjecture. It's not facts, because facts are based on proof. And people that argue against the truth, they don't like other people to bring the proof, because they'll end up losing the argument. But conjecture is in no way a substitute for the truth. That's why at the end of this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَفْعَلُونَ. Allah is all aware of what they do. This is both a threat and a promise of severe punishment. Allah said that He would reward them for their actions with a complete reward. So anyone that does good deeds will be rewarded likewise, and vice versa. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ أَن يُفْتَرَى مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلَكِنْ تَصْدِيقَ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل الكتاب لا ريب فيه من رب العالمين أم يقولون افتراه قل فأتوا بسورة مثله ودعوا من استطعتم من دون الله إن كنتم صادقين بل كذبوا بما لم يحيطوا بعلمه ولما يأتهم تأويله كذلك كذب الذين من قبلهم فانظر كيف كان عاقبة الظالمين ومنهم من يؤمن به ومنهم من لا يؤمن به ومنهم من يؤمن به ومنهم من لا يؤمن به وربك أعلم بالمفسدين. And this Quran is not such a book that could ever be produced by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it is a confirmation of the revelation which was before, and the full explanation of the book wherein there is no doubt from the Lord of all that exists. Or do they say that Muhammad has forged it? Say, bring then a surah like it and call upon anyone that you can besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you come up with a book like it if you are really truthful. Nay, they have belied the knowledge whereof they could not comprehend, and what has not yet been fulfilled. Thus, those before them did belie, then see what was the end of the wrongdoers. And among them, there are some who believe therein, and of them, there are some who do not believe, and your Lord is all aware of the mischief makers. The Quran is the true, inimitable word of Allah, and it is a miracle. The Quran has miraculous nature that cannot be imitated. No one can produce anything similar to the Quran, nor 10 surahs or even one surah like it, because of the eloquence, the clarity, the precision, and the grace of the Quran. And these cannot be except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The great and the abundant principles and meanings that lie within the Quran are of great benefit in this world and for the hereafter. And these benefits cannot come from anyone except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing like His high self and attributes, or like His sayings and actions, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is nothing like His high self and attributes, or anything like His sayings, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and His actions. Therefore, His words, which is part of them is the Quran, are not like the words of His creatures. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا كَانَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ أَن يُفْتَرَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. And this Quran is not such as could ever be produced by anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning, a book like the Quran cannot be except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. this is not similar to speech that is uttered by humans. ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه. But it is a confirmation. This Quran is a confirmation of the revelation which was before it, such as the previous revelations and books, the Torah and the Gospel. The Quran confirms that these books were in fact revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is a witness to them. But the Quran is, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, muhaiminan alayhi. Muhaiminan means a step over, a supervisor over them, because those other books, even though they were originally revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were altered by mankind. And that's why the Quran shows the changes, the perversions and corruption that have taken place within these books. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَفْصِيلَ الْكِتَابِ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ مِنْ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. And a full explanation of the book, wherein there is no doubt from the Lord of all that exists. That is, fully and truly explaining and detailing the rules and the lawful and the unlawful. With this complete and more than sufficient explanation, the Quran leaves no doubt that it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of all that exists. And obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we will see, our challenged mankind throughout history to produce a book like the Quran. I mean, the challenge is still up. And obviously if the people, the Arabs, unto whom the Quran was revealed at the time were eloquent poets, and they knew knew the art of speaking compared to the Arabs today and the rest of the world today. So if those people who were the experts in the field, the eloquent speakers, the ones that were masters of the art of speech, were not able to produce a Quran like it, do you think the Arabs today, who are less in their ability to speak and comprehend Arabic, will be able to do that? Or any other nation for that matter, the challenge is up, and anyone is challenged to come up with a Quran like this, even one surah like it, if they claim that it is not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the challenge in three steps. First, he told them, bring a Quran like this, if you are telling the truth. Of course, they couldn't produce it. And Allah told them, okay, bring 10 surah like this Quran. If you're saying that this Quran is not from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they couldn't produce 10 surah. Then Allah told them, produce just one surah, just like Surah Al-Ikhlas, you know, or Surah Inna A'tainaka Al-Kawthar, you know, a small surah. And of course, we know about Musaylim Al-Kaddab, may Allah curse him, tried to come up with something like it. As we saw a couple of weeks back when Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu, before he became Muslim, he went to Musaylim al-Kaddab, and then Musaylim al-Kaddab tried to come up with something that he said was revealed to him as a Quran. So Amr ibn al-As was laughing at him, and he said, you know that I know that you are a liar, because obviously Quran is from Allah, and what Musaylim al-Kaddab said, it is from him and from his shayateen. And of course, whatever they can come up with, human beings or jinn beings, cannot come up to the level of the Quran, cannot be as eloquent or as explanatory or can have an effect on the hearts of mankind as the Quran does. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَاهُ قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِهِ وَدَعُوا مَنِ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Or do they say, he has forged it, he has fabricated it, say, bring then a surah like this Quran and call upon whomever you can besides Allah if you are truthful, so that they can help you come up with a Quran like it. Now, if you argue, claim and doubt whether this Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then of course you have uttered a lie and blasphemy. And also you say it is from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a man like you. Not only is he a man like you, but he was illiterate, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. This is why Allah sent Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as an illiterate man, so that they don't claim that he made it with his own hands. وما كنت تتلو من قبله من كتاب ولا تخطه بيمينك إذا لارتاب المبطلون. Before this Quran was revealed to you, you were not a person that used to write and read with your own hands. Otherwise, people would have claimed that you're the one that wrote this Quran and came up with. The Prophet ﷺ was illiterate. This is by design. This is by design. So no one can say, oh, how come your Prophet is illiterate? You tell them, because a person who is illiterate is much more likely to not be able to come up with an eloquent speech like the Quran. This is just another measure for people to not argue that Muhammad ﷺ came up with this Quran, because he was illiterate. Now, as we said, Allah said, if Muhammad was one of those eloquent poets, then, you know, people would have claimed that maybe he came up with this poetry that no one else could have come up with. But of course, he was illiterate. And as we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him that's the reason why, so that people don't claim that he's the one that wrote it with his own hands, the same way he used to write poetry before, which is not the case. So, and you say it is from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they also said that someone else is helping him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Lisan ladhi yulhiduna ilayhi a'jami wa hadha lisan arabiyyun mubin." They said that, you know, some Christian guy that became Muslim, then after apostated, he went back to his people telling them that I'm the one that used to tell Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam what to say, and I used to write for him the Quran. So people said that, you know, this Christian guy was the one that helped Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam come up with the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them in the Quran, saying that this Christian guy was a foreigner, was not an Arab. So, and this is an eloquent Arabic Quran. So how can you claim that a foreigner can come up with an Arabic Quran as eloquent as the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed? So of course, all these are claims by the disbelievers to try to delude the truth, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuted their challenges with succinct and arguments to the point. So Allah says, you say it is from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is only a man like you, and says he came, as you claim, with this Quran. If you say that he came up with this Quran, then why don't you produce a surah like this Quran if you tell the truth? If you're saying that a Christian guy helped him, why don't you have all the Christians help you come up with a Quran like this? Produce something of the same nature and seek help and support with all the power that you have from humans and jinns. So you can seek the help of anyone that you want to come up with a Quran like this. Of course, you won't be able to. This is the third stage, and this is also further proof that the Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because anyone can prove that this Quran is not from Allah by coming up with a Quran like it. But of course, no one can. So this in itself is proof throughout history, because this is another thing about the miracle that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given. Actually, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given a lot of miracles, but the miracle of the Quran is a miracle that is still between us, as opposed to all the other prophets, Musa alayhi salam, Isa, Saleh, all these prophets that came before Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, their miracles happened at their time, at their times, and their people witnessed it with their own eyes. And people that came after them believed in those miracles without actually witnessing them. Like the Christians believe that Isa alayhi salam was able to bring back the dead to life. Yeah, we believe that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him that ability as a miracle to his people. But today, Isa alayhi salam cannot produce that miracle because alayhi salam was elevated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, Muhammad salam's lasting miracle, which is the Quran that Allah revealed to him, is between us today. So we can witness the miracle. Every generation that comes can witness the miracle. And this is a big point about the testimony to the truth of this religion. And the reason why, as the scholar said, is because Muhammad salam is the last messenger and no messenger after him. So the miracle of the Quran will need to keep existing for all the generations to come, for them to know that this is the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we know that many people who were animus to Islam and Muslims, after reading the Quran, they became Muslims. Why? Because they recognized in their own hearts the miracle of the Quran is the truth and it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the third stage. Allah challenged them and called them to produce a counterpart of the Quran if they were truthful in their claim that it was simply from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say, okay, so why don't you yourselves seek the help of other humans and jinn so they can produce a Quran like it? Allah even suggested that they seek help from anyone they choose. But he subhanahu wa ta'ala told them that they would not be able to. So look, this is a challenge. Like, produce if you can, and guess what? You're not going to be able to. So, you know, it can't be from human beings. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would have no way of doing so. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Isra, قُلْ لَئِنْ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسُ وَالْجِنُّ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَأْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَأْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ وَلَوْ كَانَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ ظَهِيرًا. Say, if the mankind and jinnkind were together to produce the like of this Quran, they could not produce the like thereof, even if they helped one another. then he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, reduced the number for them to 10 surahs. So we say the first challenge, bring a Quran like this. They couldn't. Then Allah reduced the challenge to 10 surahs, similar to the Quran. And this happened in the beginning of Surah Hud, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ يَقُونُونَ افْتَرَى قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِعَشْرِ سُورٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ بِعَشْرِ سُورٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَاتٍ وَادْعُوا مَنْ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Or they say, he forged it. Say, bring you then 10 forged surah like unto it, and call whomsoever you can other than Allah if you speak the truth. In this surah, in Surah Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala went further to challenge them to produce only one surah. So he said the challenge was threefold. The challenge, you know, kept on being reduced, but of course they can't answer any one of the three challenges. So Allah challenged them to produce only one surah like this. In the Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَمْ يَقُونُونَ افْتَرَاهُ قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِثْلِهِ وَدَعُوا مَنْ اسْتَطَعْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. Or do they say he has forged it? Say, bring then a surah like unto it, and call upon whomsoever you can besides Allah if you are truthful. He subhanahu wa ta'ala also challenged them in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is a Madinah surah. It was revealed in Medina to produce one surah similar to the Quran. He stated in Surah Al-Baqarah that they would never be able, that they would never be capable of them. And say, well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَا تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارِ. And if you do it not, if you can't produce a Quran like this, then you can never produce it. If you don't produce it and you can never produce it, then fear the fire. It should be noted here that eloquence was part of the nature and character of the Arabs. As we said, you know, Arabic poetry included al-mu'allaqat. Al-mu'allaqat is the oldest complete collection of the most eloquent and ancient Arabic poems. It was considered to be the best in the literary arts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave this challenge to the experts in the Arabic language at the time. Now, of course, the Arabs today can't claim to be experts just like their ancestors because of everything that happened throughout history, of the mixing, of occupations, etc. But still, if they think that they can come up with a Quran like it, then let them take up the challenge and let them know that they won't be able to do it. So we said that the mu'allaqat was considered to be the best in the literary arts. However, Allah sent down to them something whose style none were familiar with, and no one is equal in stature to imitate. So no one can imitate the Quran, even though they were eloquent. So those who believed among them, among the Arabs, believed because of what they knew and felt in the book, including its beauty, elegance, benefit, and fluency, because they were experts in the art. So they recognized that the Quran was not part of their poetry and part of their eloquence in speech. They knew it was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because, you know, an expert is the one who is bound to know the truth. And that's why we'll see here that the magicians during Fir'aun's time, they were experts in magic. So when they saw the miracle of Musa alayhi salam, they knew that this was not magic, because they were experts in the field. So they would have recognized magic, but what they saw, that whatever Musa came with was not magic, it was a miracle. It came from someone that was supported and guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They knew that no human being could perform such acts without permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Isa alayhi salam at the time of scholarly medicine and during the advancement in the treatment of patients. So of course, people were very knowledgeable about medicine, and yet they could not heal the blind, they could not heal leprosy, they could not raise the dead back to life. But Isa alayhi salam was given these miracles by Allah's leave as a challenge to them. And of course, the experts in medicine at the time knew that what Isa alayhi salam came with was miracles, and it was not knowledge of medicine. As a result, those who believed in him, they knew that he was Allah's servant and his messenger, because they were experts in the matter. Similarly, in the Sahih, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma min nabiyyin min al-anbiya illa wa qad utiya min al-ayati ma amana ala mithlihi al-bashar wa innama kana alladhi utituhu wahyan awhahu Allahu ilayya fa arju an akuna aktharuhum tabi'a." There was never a prophet, but he was given signs by which the people at his time would recognize him. But that which I was given is a revelation that Allah revealed, and it will continue to exist throughout eternity until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to lift it before the end of times. So I hope that I will have the most followers among them. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the prophets, بَلْ كَذَّبُوا بِمَا لَمْ يُحِيطُوا بِعِلْمِهِ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِهِمْ تَأْوِيلُهُ. Nay, they belied the knowledge whereof they could not comprehend, and what has not yet been fulfilled. They did not believe in the Quran. They did not believe in the Quran, and they have not yet grasped it or comprehended it. وَلَمَّا يَأْتِهِمْ تَأْوِيلُهُ And what has not yet been fulfilled. They have not attained the guidance and the true religion. So they belied it out of ignorance and foolishness. And of course, Allah promised them the punishment because of their disbelief. And of course, the punishment has not been fulfilled yet. And that's why they belied in the Quran. And that's how the ones before them did. كَذَلِكَ كَذَّبَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ Those before them did belie, meaning the past nations that Allah spoke about in the Quran also belied their messengers and then see how was their end, how was the end of the wrongdoers. فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الظَّالِمِينَ Look how we destroyed them because they denied our messengers in their wickedness, in their pride, in their stubbornness and ignorance. So beware you who deny the message that the same end will befall you. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ لَا يُؤْمِنُ بِهِ وَرَبُّكَ أَعْلَمُ بِالْمُفْسِدِينَ And among them, there are some who believe in the Qur'an. That means among those you were sent to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are people who believe in this Qur'an, like the companions radiallahu anhum. They will follow you and benefit from what has been sent to you. And among them, there are some who will not believe. And they will die as disbelievers, and they will be resurrected as such and be punished. A severe punishment because of their disbelief, and your Lord is all aware of the mischief makers. Allah knows who deserves guidance, who want to be guided, Allah guides them, and those that are stubborn and don't want to be guided and they're happy with their status quo, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves them in their misguidance. He best knows those who deserve guidance and He guides them, and those who deserve to go astray, He allows them to go astray because it's their own choice. Allah is, however, the just who is never unjust. He gives everyone what they deserve. All glory is His, the exalted. There is no God worthy of worship but He. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن كَذَّبُوكَ فَقُلْ لِي عَمَلِي وَلَكُمْ عَمَلُكُمْ أَنتُمْ بَرِيئُونَ مِمَّا أَعْمَلُ وَأَنَا بَرِيءٌ مِمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَسْتَمِعُونَ إِلَيْكَ أَفَأَنتَ تُسْمِعُ الصُّمَّ وَلَوْ كَانُوا لَا يَعْقِلُونَ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَيْكَ أَفَأَنتَ تَهْدِي الْعُمْيَ وَلَوْ كَانُوا لَا يُبَصِرُونَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَظْلِمُ النَّاسَ شَيْئًا وَلَكِنَّ النَّاسَ أَنفُسَهُمْ يَظْلِمُونَ And if they belie you, say, for me, there are my deeds, and for you are your deeds. You are innocent of what I do, and I am innocent of what you do. And among them are some who listen to you. But can you make the deaf hear, even though they apprehend not? And among them are some who look at you, but can you guide the blind, even though they cannot see? Truly, Allah does not wrong mankind in aught, but mankind wrong themselves. The command to be free and clear from the idolaters. Allah said to His Prophet ﷺ, if these idolaters belie you, O Muhammad ﷺ, then be clear from them and their deeds. فَقُلْ لِي عَمَلِي وَلَكُمْ عَمَلُكُمْ Say, for me are my deeds of worship, and for you are your deeds of disbelief. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Kafirun, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ Say, O you who disbelievers, O you disbelievers, I worship not that which you worship. I worship not that which you worship. To the end of Surah Al-Kafirun. Ibrahim Al-Khalil, the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his followers said to the idolaters among their people, Inna bura'a'u minkum wa mimma ta'buduna min dunillah. Verily, we are free from you and whatever you worship besides Allah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us the beneficial knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins, to cure the sick among us, to have mercy on the dead among us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and our families and our provisions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide the Muslims back to the true path. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather the Muslims on a single rule that will bring them back to the glory that they were created for. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift the injustice from all the Muslims throughout the world. And finally, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fi jannat al-firdaws al-'ulya wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.